The war between Israel and Hamas is the latest escalation in the decades-long complicated history of both sides. Let's take a look at what led to this situation with security analyst Romel Banlawi. Mr. Banlawi is the chairman of the Philippine Institute for Peace, Violence, and Terrorism Research. Professor Banlawi, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karian, and good morning to all.
All right. Now, before we talk about the complex and lengthy history between both countries, let's start first with the intelligence failure. Israel didn't see this coming, but why would Hamas do this now?
Well, this is an opportune time for Hamas to do it because Hamas has already developed the capability to mount violent attacks against Israeli interests, not only in Gaza, but also in other parts of the state of Israel. And at the same time, Hamas was also able to gather enough fighters with support not only of extremist Hamas followers, but also support from neighboring state Lebanon, especially with Hezbollah. And at the same time, Hamas was able to gather enough mass support in order to mount this kind of violent incident. So this was an opportune time for Hamas because of its capability and strong intention to pursue its political and religious agenda.
Okay. Now, while the controversial partition, the partition when it comes to Gaza, the West Bank in the 1940s, they've gone through several escalation through the years. What is it, Professor Banlawi, considering that Israel does to a degree support the Gaza Strip in terms of utilities, food? It's quite surprising why this would still happen.
Well, we have to understand, Karen, that there are many forces in the area, and that area is supposedly divided into two major states, the state of Israel and the state of Palestine. And we have to remember that the Philippines supported, initially opposed the partition plan of that area in 1947, but we eventually decided to vote in favor of the partition plan. And that partition plan recognizes the establishment of the state of Israel. So we recognize that Israel is an independent state, but let us not lose of the sight that we also recognize the establishment of a Palestinian state. In fact, as we speak, there is a diplomatic relationship between the Philippines and the state of Palestine, and we recognize the state of Palestine. Unfortunately, in 1967, there was a six-day war in the area, and as a result of that six-day war, Israel was able to occupy West Bank, Gaza Strip, and to a certain extent, Golan Heights. And that is the context of why the Palestinians are struggling for their right for self-determination to have an independent state. And they feel that they have been occupied very long by the state of Israel. But this is the problem now. Hamas has a different narrative. Hamas does not only struggle for the establishment of an independent Palestinian state and struggling for the right of self-determination of the Palestinian people, but they also have the intention for the destruction of the state of Israel. Yes, so that's the problem with Hamas.
It is the eradication of Israel. Yes. Yeah.
So that's the problem with the extremist, fundamentalist, violent perspective, you know. They have this kind of intention. At the same time, the state of Israel has the intention also for the destruction of Hamas. So they have this intention of mutual destruction, and that is now fueling violence in the area.
All right. So good points there. So I've been to Israel and the West Bank. I haven't been to Gaza yet. But you have Israel that's surrounded by her enemies, right? So you have Hezbollah, the Lebanon being on the northern part of Israel, Gaza being on the western southern part of Israel, but the West Bank being on the eastern part. Are you seeing any threats coming from the West Bank, or with the escalation, are we looking at only Hamas and Hezbollah in the situation?
Well, that is the thing that the international community needs to prevent the escalation of conflict from Gaza Strip to other parts of Israel like West Bank, because West Bank is also an occupied territory. But this is the dynamics of the Palestinian people. You know, the Palestinian people is also a diverse society. There is a Palestinian Jew supporting also a coexistence with their fellow Israeli Jew, Palestinian Christians, and Palestinian Muslims. It is in the West Bank where we see a lot of extremist elements because of the existence of Muslim fundamentalist followers of Hamas. In West Bank, there are various forces there, Palestinian Jews, Palestinian Christians, Palestinian Muslims, but there is an intention also on the part of Hamas to extend their influence to the West Bank, because they want to really declare the whole area as part of the state of Palestine, and they want the establishment not only of an independent Palestinian state, but an independent Islamic state of Palestine. Mm-hmm. And some Palestinians do not share that kind of narrative because they are moderate Palestinians, you know. And this kind of narrative is only being advocated by Hamas. And that is the context on why the Israeli government wants a destruction of the Hamas, because it's very difficult to negotiate with extremists. So,
but is it right? I wanted to ask you, Professor, this is very good discussion. Is it still right to define Hamas as extremist when Israel withdrew from the territory in 2005? In effect, Hamas is the government right now in Gaza, right? They are the de facto authority there. They run the government. Yes. In other words, they can redefine Gaza into the kind of territory they want it to be. They're in power.
That's the complication of the situation in Gaza, because Hamas was able to get popular support, and the people there, the Palestinian people there, share the narratives of Hamas of establishing an independent Palestinian Islamic state. Islamic state. But we have to take into account that not all Palestinians are Muslims. There are Palestinian Jews, there are Palestinian Christians, and therefore not comfortable with the establishment of Islamic state. So if Hamas insists of doing that in Gaza Strip, we just hope that they will not propagate that to other parts of Israel, like West Bank. Okay. So that's the problem. You know, in West Bank there are a lot of moderates. There are a lot of Palestinian people willing to compromise with the state of Israel, willing for a peaceful coexistence with the Israelis. But Hamas does not have that kind of agenda. Hamas has the intention of the full destruction of the Israel and even eradication of the Jews in that area, because they believe that the area is the land for the Muslim, the land for the Islamic State, which is different from the narrative of Israeli, because that land is the land for the Jewish people.
Oh, all right. But okay. But then, hence, this is why the United Nations in 1947, right, essentially mediated and partitioned the land. But yes, I agree with you. It's much deeper than this. But let's move on a bit to today, right? So clearly, Hamas is the aggressor. But now Israel has declared all-out war. They're in a state of war. So my question is, you even have the likes of former President Duterte saying Israel should wipe off Hamas from the face of the earth. Let's talk about the response. Israel's response, quite clearly, you have Hamas also coming out right now, the Palestinian people coming out right now on international media. Some would say now they are playing the victim when they were the aggressor. But let's put the balance here. Is Israel's response, how would you say this, the right word is it apt?
Well, right now, there is a global perception that Israeli is reacting very strongly against the Hamas. And that is why UN Secretary General Guterres appealed to the Israeli government to be mindful of the implementation of existing international humanitarian law. So that is why right now under the current situation, what is very important is the protection of civilian in armed conflict. So we need to, the state of Israel must provide a conducive environment for the protection of civilian in terms of armed conflicts. Because if you hit civilians, especially Palestinian civilians, sympathetic to the cause of Hamas, that will compound the situation in the area. So that is the main objective now is the protection of civilian. And also
didn't Hamas start this? Didn't they start kidnapping children, mothers? Didn't they start abducting civilians in that music festival? Didn't they start killing civilians first?
Yes, that's the fact. But it's more than that. It's very difficult to put the situation, you know, describing who are the bad guys or the good guys, who are the victims and the aggressors. Not simply as that, you know, it's not black and white. The issue is complicated because if you will look at the narrative of Hamas and especially the Palestinian people in Gaza Strip, they are saying that the action of Hamas against Israel is a product of a series of state violence against the Palestinian people in Gaza Strip. So that's their narrative. So there is a competing narrative between the two people. But what is very important now is for the two parties to be reminded of the efforts of the international community to offer a two-state solution to the problem. You know, if they will not, they need to take stock of all the peace agreements made after the 1967 war. They made a lot of peace agreements already. So we have to take stock of the achievements and deal with all the obstacles, you know. If Hamas is not ready to negotiate with the state of Israel, we will only see violence in the area. That is why the Western world, especially the United States, is against the Hamas because the Hamas has a very extremist perspective. And I am personally against violent extremism because it's very difficult to negotiate with extremists. Okay. So you have to find a common ground.
But perhaps that's why you just said it. It's very difficult to negotiate with extremists, hence Israel's response. You see, you said it's very difficult to negotiate with extremists. Hence, Benjamin Netanyahu's response is not to negotiate. But when you don't negotiate, what is the effect? What is the consequence in a global geopolitical spectrum? You have Iran that's supporting Hamas, right? So what happens if you don't negotiate with Hamas?
Well, you have to negotiate with other parties because Hamas is not only the Palestinian people. There are other Palestinian people, and let's hear their narrative. What's the narrative of the other Palestinians, the Palestinian Jews, the Palestinian Christians? You know, there are also Palestinian Muslims who do not share the extremist narrative of Hamas.
If I were to ask you, who should Israel negotiate with in the Gaza Strip?
Well, right now, it has no...
The Palestinians in the West Bank are not acting.
Well, right now they have to deal with Hamas and stop the violence with Hamas. You know, right now if Hamas will not de-escalate its acts of violence against the Israeli government, we can only expect the Israeli government to retaliate violently also. So that would be the sad situation in the area. It will be marred by violence, and I think it's time for the international community to have a very positive intervention in the area. And unfortunately, as we speak right now, the UN Security Council is still divided over the issue of the situation in the Gaza Strip. You know, so we need to get decisive position of the UN Security Council on how to act on the current situation in the Gaza Strip. But meanwhile, Hamas is an extremist organization and it has its own political agenda. So its agenda is to destroy Israel, and of course Israel will defend itself. You know, and some
So my question is, Professor, is it right to wipe Hamas off the face of the earth? That's the question.
Well, for me, we need to wipe out any organization like Hamas espousing violent extremism. Because,
but do you
know,
wipe them out through violence too?
There are many ways of wiping them out. And I just would like to set the example of how we reduce terrorist threats in the Philippines. There are other non-military options in order to deal with violent extremism. And the Philippines, you know, implemented a lot of non-violent options, non-military options. And right now, the threat of terrorism in the Philippines is declining. And do you know, Karen, that
Can you
Hamas
give some examples of that? Can you give
like,
some examples?
Like, for example, involvement of the local government to improve the quality of governance in the area, and at the same time, the participation of the private sector and civil society. They believe in the narrative that there is a need to counter violent extremism in that area. So they participated in that non-military efforts, convincing people that violent extremism can only lead to violence. So what we need is to counter violent extremism. We need to counter violence. We need to counter extremism. So we need to propagate the idea of peaceful coexistence with each other. So unless Hamas accepts that idea of peaceful coexistence with the state of Israel, it's difficult to really reduce violence in the area. So we need a narrative that will be more moderate. You know, I look forward to to see an organization like the Al Fatah, no? I want Al Fatah to revive, because Al Fatah is a moderate organization.
I mean, clearly, I agree with you that you're talking about the ideal, right? But the issue now is, if you wipe out Hamas from the face of the earth, and the response is an all-out war, does it stop there? I mean, what happens after then to other groups who are supportive of Hamas?
Well, that's the difficulties now in the current situation. Hamas was able to develop mass support in Gaza Strip, and that is why they won the
election. But what about the role of Iran? The role of Iran in this situation?
Iran also has a role to play, because Iran is supporting Hamas, and also Lebanon. Why? Because Iran also has the intention of fighting Israel, and Lebanon also has that kind of intention. Though there is also a geopolitics in that area. You know, they have the same remorse against the state of Israel. That is why we need the international community also needs to talk to Iran and Lebanon to convince Hamas to de-escalate the current violence. So what we need right now is a ceasefire. You know, they need to come out with a ceasefire agreements and discuss these things out, because if they will not, if there will be no ceasefire, we will only see more and more violence, and violence can foment more grievances. You know, if you see dying people in the area, it creates another form of narratives that makes the solution of the problem more and more difficult. But again, I need to emphasize, there is also an internationally accepted solution to address the conflict between Palestine and Israel, and that is the two-state solution. So, unfortunately, Hamas is...
Talk about the two-state solution.
Meaning, we have to recognize that there must be an independent Palestine, independent Palestinian state, and also an independent Jewish state of Israel. So that's why they have to accept the idea of peaceful coexistence. Because if they will not accept the idea of peaceful coexistence, we need to deal with violence for a long, long time. So
okay.
That's the situation that we find ourselves in that area.
Okay. Now, I wanted to ask you, you talked about two separate states, right? The two-state solution. Now, the state of Palestine has been recognized already by at least 139 UN members of the United Nations. That was 2012, correct?
Including the Philippines.
Including the Philippines. So technically, won't that be defined already as a two-state solution? But until today, Palestine is still a non-member state in the UN. So does that really make it two-state? Or it seems like it's more of a token state?
Yeah, this is the situation now. We recognize the state of Palestine. Unfortunately, territories that are intended for the state of Palestine are occupied by the state of Israel. And we talk about West Bank and Gaza Strip. And that is why the Hamas is advocating for a free Palestine, because as long as the Israeli forces continue to occupy West Bank and Gaza Strip, they cannot fully realize their statehood. And that is the context on why Hamas is doing this kind of violence. This is their narrative. They are fighting. This is a war of national liberation for them.
Correct.
A war of national liberation. So we have, and the state of Israel must also recognize that that's the context of their violent activities. They are struggling for war of national liberation. So, and the Palestinian people recognize that, whether Jews, Christians, or Muslims, they want an independent Palestine, but they differ on the method. And Hamas, which is a dominant political and most influential political group in West Bank, has the support of the people in Gaza Strip to continue this kind of violence as a justification to mount a war of national liberation. So, yeah. The perceptions of others that these are acts of terrorism, but in their perceptions, these are acts of wars of national liberation. So for others, they are terrorists. Be reminded of Yasser Arafat's statement before the UN General Assembly before, that one man's terrorist might be the other man's freedom fighters. And for the people, the Palestinian people in Gaza Strip, Hamas is a freedom fighter. So
yes,
that's encouraging Hamas to continue these violent activities.
Yeah, but then let's put some balance here. I mean, I've been to Israel, I've been to the West Bank, right? So you have the West Bank that's still militarily occupied by Israel, but then a wall separates them. A wall separates them, and the wall exists until today. And then Palestinians cannot enter Israel. Palestinians coming from the West Bank. So there's a checkpoint. And the purpose for that checkpoint is, well, number one, if you come from Israel and you visit the country, you'll also see the development from nothing, what the Israelis have made it to. I mean, it's technologically advanced. It's innovative. So you're talking about from nothing, how the Israelis as a people and a nation made it into something. And yet the surrounding parts of Israel, which are mostly Arab and Muslim, are poor. So you're also seeing a difference here of the people itself. And while ideally the wall shouldn't exist, it exists because they feel they've been attacked. One was Yom Kippur, in the middle of a holiday, in the middle of a celebration, and then again now. So if you are Israeli, if you're Israel, you are right smack in the middle of your enemies, huh? You're not like near the ocean. Well, you are, I mean, the Mediterranean, but technically all your enemies are around you. What would you do?
Well, I understand the situation of the state of Israel. You know, the state of Israel is really surrounded by a lot of hostile neighbors because of the product
all
of
the difference in faith
history.
Too. Yeah. All a difference in faith as well.
Yes, yes. Yeah, because it's a product of the Arab-Israeli conflict. And that is why we need to go beyond this stereotyping, you know, the Arab versus the Jews. It will take time for them to eradicate this kind of stereotype against each other. But meanwhile, the most important thing to do right now is to de-escalate the current violence in the area. So find ways on how to protect civilians. If the Hamas will not stop from its violent activities, of course, we expect the state of Israel to also retaliate militarily, but the international community needs to take action in order to protect innocent civilians, especially foreign nationals in the area, like Filipino overseas workers. That's the crucial thing, because it's very difficult to solve right now the current conflict between the state of Israel and Hamas, because both parties have the intention to destroy each other.
Good point. You said ceasefire, de-escalate. My last question is, who should be the mediator? Should it be the United States?
It has always been the United Nations. Always remember, it has always been the United Nations. It was the United Nations that created the partition plan. It was the United Nations that facilitated a lot of peace accords in the area. So the United Nations should continue its role in maintaining peace in that area and making it sure that all efforts in the past in promoting peace and stability in that area will not put to waste.
Okay, now what about the United States? Of course, the United States has been an ally of Israel since 1948. They're a strong ally, but clearly the United States can have, what role do you think can it have in terms of de-escalation?
I'm very sorry, Karen, but the UN is not a nonpartisan player in that area.
Oh, you mean the United States?
Yeah, the United States. The United States is not a nonpartisan player in that area, because the US is really siding with the state of Israel. So for Hamas and even for the other Palestinian people, the US is not a neutral player, because it is siding with the state of Israel. In fact, President Joe Biden made a declaration that it will demonstrate an ironclad support to the state of Israel. Even during the time of President Donald Trump, he even recognized Jerusalem as the capital of the state of Israel. That angered not only the Palestinian people, but also the Arab people all over Middle East and North Africa. So the U.S. cannot be a neutral player. For me, it's the United Nations, the UN Security Council, and we need to take stock of all the UN Security Council resolutions about that area. So right now, the peace and stability in the state of Israel and in the Palestinian Authority will largely rest on the decisive actions of the United Nations.
Okay, but my last question is, some have called the UN ineffective. I mean, you've seen Russia, Ukraine, now Israel, Hamas, right? So Russia, Ukraine, you haven't seen major developments there when it comes to essentially dialoguing and peace. And my last question is, If you have some sectors that are not hopeful with the United Nations Security Council, what about the EU? Are you seeing the EU as a possible mediator?
It's also very difficult to include the European Union, because the European Union are composed of members, Western members, with large support of the Jewish communities. You know that's a problem. That's a complicated problem if you involve other players considered to be partisan by the Palestinians. So for me, the only viable third party mediator would be the United Nations. For me, the European Union cannot play that kind of neutral role, because many Jewish people in the European Union are in fact supporting the state of Israel, and we understand them. Because they regard that area as a homeland for the Jewish people. Remember, that's their homeland for the Jewish people. But we need a nonpartisan entity, and that is the United Nations. The United Nations may be slow in addressing the problem, but do we have any other option, more peaceful option? If you will look at the option of the European Union and the United States, they are siding with the state of Israel, but they're also members of the European Union siding with the Palestinian people. But let us listen to the statement of UN Secretary General.
All right. Yeah, well, I want to thank you so much for this insightful conversation, Dr. Romel Banlawi. Thank you, sir. I do
Thank
hope
you
to
very
speak
much,
with you
Karen.
again, sir. All
God
right.
bless you.
Take care.
Thank you very
Take
much.
care.